Wow, well, thank you for that introduction. Just real quick before you're seated. Man, just as Reggie just said, you know, right now you're standing, not just to honor me, but to honor the Word of God that is about ready to be preached through me. And I just believe that today, that faith is going to come alive in your life like never before. You see, because faith comes by hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word about Jesus. And I'm here to tell somebody this morning that Jesus is going to be preached today. Jesus is going to be magnified. And if you believe that, can we just give Jesus one more praise in this place this morning? Thank you, Jesus. Amen. You guys can go ahead and be seated, and you guys can be seated. Thank you guys so much. Man, well, happy Easter, church. How are we doing today? Good. I just wanted to just get this whole thing started just by asking you a question. I'm curious, how many of you enjoy going on road trips? Let me see your hands. All right, leave your hands up. All right, for those of you with your hands raised, how many of you have small children and you still enjoy going on road trips? Yeah, that's what I thought. I'm one of six kids, and man, I remember when I was a kid, you know, being one of six, when we wanted to go somewhere, you know, my mom and dad, we couldn't afford to fly, so when we wanted to go, we loaded up the van, and we drove, right? And I remember being so frustrated as a kid, and I was frustrated because when we would go on these trips, my brothers and sisters, they would always forget to bring things to occupy their time. So what do you think they did? Man, they messed with me. Right, and we started fighting, and then Dad's yelling out from the driver's seat, "Don't make me come back there. Don't make me pull this car over." But the thing that frustrated me the most was that because they were bored, they were constantly crying out those four words that every parent hates to hear on road trips: "Are we there yet? Dad, are we there yet?" Now, my dad, I'm going to be honest, he is one of the most patient guys that I know. If you know Pastor Darrow, you know that is true about him. And he would always, you know, try to explain to my 5 and 6 year old brothers and sisters that, hey, you know, no, we're not there yet, not yet, you know, and he would give the distance, talk about the speed, like they understood what he was talking about, and then gave an estimated time of arrival. And now with me and my boys, you think I would have learned, but I'm not so patient. I didn't learn, I guess, that from my dad, because last year I took my family on a road trip. We went to Destin. You know, a 9 or 10 hour trip in the car, and I kid you not, an hour into our drive, man, we're still in the middle of Kentucky, and they're crying out, "Dad, are we there yet?" Man, I got so upset, so frustrated. They kept on asking and kept on asking. Matter of fact, we were in the middle of Alabama somewhere. They asked me again. I got fed up with it. I pulled off on some random exit, and it wasn't about ready to be Roll Tide. It was going to be Roll Some Tears, because I got off, found this little pond next door, next to the road, and I said, "All right, kids, we're here. There's the ocean. Get out. Let's have fun. Are we there yet?" "Yes, we are." They're like, "Dad, you're stupid. This is dumb. Get back in the car." So I got back in. We drove off, but hey, don't judge me. Don't judge me right now. I see some of y'all's looks right now, but the rest of the way there and the entire way back, guess what? They didn't ask me again. I'm going somewhere with this, I promise. You know, it's funny how kids are only concerned with the destination. And because they're only concerned with the destination, they forget to enjoy the journey. And I came here to tell somebody, we're a lot like that in our walk with Christ. That we only think about the destination. We only have some finish line in mind, like one day I'll arrive. But I want to let you know that there is joy in the journey with Jesus. And I came to share that with you this morning. So I'm just curious, are you ready to go on a journey with me this morning? You ready to walk with me? All right, let's go. If you brought your Bibles, you can get them out and turn with me to Luke chapter 24. Luke 24, we're going to start in verse 13. If you don't have your Bible, it's all good, because there are three really big ones behind me on the screen. And we're just going to kind of watch as two disciples went on this journey and how Jesus showed up to them and showed them his goodness, and I promise you, it'll be the same for us today. Let's go. Verse 13, this is what Luke writes. He says, "Now that same day," what day is he talking about? He's talking about Resurrection Sunday, the first Easter Sunday, right? The day that Jesus overcame sin, death, and the grave. The day that God exalted him to the highest place, gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. We're talking about that day, right? This is the day. Now, that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus. Everybody say Emmaus. See, what you have to know about Emmaus was that it was just this little town or village in the middle of nowhere. Matter of fact, if you go to Israel today, tour guides will tell you that they think they know where it's at, but they have to put a disclaimer that they're not really for certain. You see, Emmaus, it means obscurity. And these two were going towards this village called Emmaus in obscurity, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They're on this 7-mile journey. Verse 14, they were talking with each other about everything that had happened, right, with Jesus and him going to the cross and him being laid in the tomb. They talked about all of that in verse 15. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus, I want you to see this, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But verse 16, but they were kept from recognizing him. They didn't know it was Jesus. They couldn't see Jesus clearly. And I gotta believe that maybe that's somebody here this morning. Maybe you can't see Jesus clearly for who he truly is. You know, everybody else seems to have this great relationship with him, that they talk with him on a daily basis, but you can't even see him. You can't even relate to him. I want you to know that that's okay, because Jesus came for you. You see, the first thing we learn in our journey in this story is this. If you're taking notes, I want you to write this down. This is so important to see, and this is so good. Number one, the first thing I want you to see on this journey is this. Jesus comes for the turn back. Jesus comes for the turn back. Oh, this is so good. You see, Luke tells us that two of them were on this journey. Now, a little bit later, we're going to know one of these disciples' names was Cleopas, right? We're going to call him Cleo. But the other disciple, he doesn't mention. There's no name given. And I love that Luke doesn't give a name for two reasons. The first reason, because there's no name given, that tells me that I can put myself in this story. This tells you that you can put yourself in this story, on this journey with Jesus. And then the second reason why the name might not be mentioned, and I'm just going to be quite frank today, most scholars believe that this other disciple was Cleopas' wife, right? Mrs. Cleo. But here's the deal. In this culture, in this day, women were not seen as very important. They weren't seen as significant, so maybe that's why Luke didn't write her name down. And here's the deal. Maybe that's how you feel this morning. You feel overlooked. You feel insignificant. You feel like your life is headed towards nowhere. Well, let this minister to you this morning. Man, I love this. You see, Jesus, the first thing that he does when he gets up out of the tomb, now you think it would be to go show himself to Pilate, right? The guy that sends him to death. You think he might go to all those Roman soldiers that crucified him. Man, talk about an influence. Talk about a difference in Rome that could have been made, right? Man, Jesus, at least go, man, to some people we've heard of before. At least go to Peter, right? That's your rock. At least go to John. That's the disciple that you loved. Man, Jesus, at least go to Nathaniel. I've heard of that dude before. But here Jesus shows up to two people that we have never even heard of before, that a lot of people probably overlooked, that a lot of people thought were insignificant, but Jesus Christ came to them. I came to tell somebody this morning, it doesn't matter who you are or what you've done, Jesus is in constant pursuit of you. Come on, is there anybody in here that knows they have everlasting life because Jesus never gave up on you? That Jesus was always in pursuit of you. Let me just share just a little bit of my story. So I grew up in church. My parents were pastors, so from the moment I was born, I was in church, specifically this church. And I remember being here on Sunday mornings, Sunday nights, Wednesday nights, not to mention all the other times through the week because my dad worked here, right? But I'm going to be honest, I loved church as a kid. I loved being here. I loved the things of God. As a matter of fact, I came to know Jesus at an early age. I wanted to serve him. I wanted to help in his church. But somewhere along the way, at around 18 or 19 years old, I began to walk away from the things of God. I began to turn my back towards God and His church. Now, I still came to church, but I was just going through the motions. I wasn't looking to get involved. I wasn't looking to serve and use my gifts, even though I knew I had a calling on my life from an early age to be in ministry. But I began to walk away and to pursue other things. And this whole season of me walking away, kind of asking the question, now what? What am I supposed to do? The whole time, God was just tugging on my heart. And I came to recognize this, that no matter where I went, no matter what season I was in, that God was not only just with me, but He was for me and He still loved me. And then I remember getting my Bible out and opening it to Psalm chapter 23. It's only 6 verses. I encourage you later on today maybe to go read it. But there's 2 verses specifically in that just really ministered to me during this season. Verse 4 says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Now, I wasn't in a season where I was in the valley of the shadow of death, but I was in a season where I was in the valley of the shadow of doubt in my life. And maybe that's where a lot of you are at this morning. Maybe with some doubts, maybe with some disappointments. But if you finish that verse, it goes, but I will fear no evil, because I know that you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. And then verse 6, it really set everything in motion for me. It changed my entire perspective. It says this, surely, meaning for sure, you can have confidence in this. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. And I was old enough to know how to do a word study. So I looked up that verse in the Hebrew, and specifically that word follow. And that word follow is the word in the Hebrew that means to go after, to pursue, or to hunt down. You see, what I realized back then and what I hope you will realize today is that God's grace chases you down. You see, these two, they were on a journey from Jerusalem to Emmaus. You see, what is so important about that is that Jerusalem was where they just had Passover. Jerusalem is where they just had the meal with Jesus. In Jerusalem is where Jesus told them to stay, right? He told his disciples to stay in Jerusalem and wait on the promise, the Holy Spirit. But these two didn't listen to Jesus. In a sense, they kind of turned their back on Jesus. But the first thing that Jesus does when he gets up out of the grave is he heads right to them. I'm telling you, Jesus comes for the turn back. The second thing I want you to see on this journey, to see the goodness of God, to see the joy in this journey with Jesus is this. If you're taking notes, write this down. Number 2, Jesus comes for the hurting heart. Maybe that's where you're at. You've got some disappointments. Jesus comes for you. Let's go back to the story. So Cleo and Mrs. Cleo, right, they're on this journey to Emmaus. Jesus comes alongside. They don't know it's Jesus. And then in verse 17, check this out. Jesus, he asked them, what are you discussing together as you walk along? They stood still, their faces downcast. So they were walking, but something stopped them in their tracks. What was it? Disappointment. Unmet expectations. Check this out. One of them named Cleopas asked him, this is so funny. Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days? And this is funny because he's talking to Jesus, right? Jesus is the creator of all things. He knows all things. He knows how many hairs are on Cleo's head. And yet Cleo is asking him, do you know what's going on? And the things he's asking Jesus about, all these things that have happened, happened to Jesus. And that's who he's talking to. I don't know about you, but I find the Bible hilarious. This is so good. And then Jesus goes on. You know, we see through all the Gospels, whenever Jesus is asked a question, a lot of times he responds with a question. Well, that's what happens here. Check this out. Verse 19. I love this. What things? Can you just kind of see Jesus saying this? What are you talking about? Just let me in on what you think you know about what's going on. And then they both replied almost simultaneously because it says they replied, about Jesus of Nazareth. I mean, come on, really? He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. Verse 21, but we had hoped. I'm going to stop there for just a minute. But we had hoped. How many of us have used that same 4-word phrase in our relationship with God? God, but we had hoped our life would have been different. But God, we had hoped that you would have come through in a different way. But God, we had hoped that, man, we would have already had kids by now. But God, we had hoped we'd already be in this position in our careers by now. How many of us ask this very same thing? You see, these people, they started out with hope, but somewhere along the way, they lost it. And I'm going to show you why. Check this out. He said, but we had hoped that he was the one that was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. You see, they were around and heard Jesus when he said he was going to rise again on the third day. And it's the third day, but they hadn't seen him yet. But here's the deal. They didn't see him because they didn't wait long enough. If they would have just waited two or three more hours, they would have seen him along with the rest of the disciples. But because they got up that morning, okay, it's the third day. Where is Jesus? He needs to be here. Oh, he's not here. All right, we're going home. They didn't wait around on God's timing, and maybe that's where you're at this morning. Verse 22. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Verse 24, then some of our companions, Peter and John, right? They ran and went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see Jesus. You see, they were concerned because they didn't see him. And I'm reminded of Thomas, right? Thomas, Jesus shows up to the disciples, but Thomas wasn't in the room. Jesus leaves. Thomas comes in. The disciples are like, hey, Jesus was just here. And Thomas said, nope, unless I, what, see his scars, put my finger where his where those nails were, put my hand into his side, unless I can do that, I'm not going to believe. And that's where these two disciples were. They were in this moment, but Jesus came to minister to them, right? He came for the hurting heart. And check out what he does, and I hope this ministers to you. Verse 25, he said, how foolish you are and how slow to believe. Are we slow to believe? All that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? Verse 27, and beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all. Everybody say all. All the scriptures concerning himself. Now, I don't know if you realize this or not. What's going on in this moment is that during this 7-mile journey, Jesus is unpacking and revealing himself in all the scriptures. Now, all the scriptures during this time wouldn't have been the New Testament. That wasn't scripture yet. It would have been from Genesis to Malachi. And in this moment, Jesus is revealing who he is in every single book along the way. You see, what they would have discovered was this. It would have been something like this. So in Genesis, right, he is the seed of the woman. In Exodus, he is the Passover lamb. In Leviticus, he is our high priest. In Numbers, he is the pillar of cloud by day and fire by night. In Deuteronomy, he is the prophet likened to Moses. In Joshua, he is the captain of our salvation. In Judges, he is our judge and lawgiver. In Ruth, he is our kinsman redeemer. In 1 and 2 Samuel, he is our trusted prophet. In Kings and Chronicles, he is our reigning king. In Ezra, he is our faithful scribe. In Nehemiah, he is the rebuilder of broken down walls of human life. In Esther, he is our Mordecai. In Job, he is our dayspring on high and our ever-living redeemer. For I know that my redeemer lives. Come on, somebody. In Psalms, he is the Lord, our shepherd. I shall not want. In Proverbs and Ecclesiastes, he is our wisdom. In Song of Solomon, he is the lover and our bridegroom. In Isaiah, he is the prince of peace. In Jeremiah, he is the righteous branch. In Lamentations, he is our weeping prophet. In Ezekiel, he is the wonderful four-faced man. In Daniel, he is the fourth man in the burning fiery furnace. In Hosea, he is the faithful husband, forever married to the backslider. Don't forget that. In Joel, he is the baptizer with the Holy Ghost and with fire. In Amos, he is our burden bearer. In Obadiah, he is mighty to save. In Jonah, he is the great foreign missionary. In Micah, he is a messenger of beautiful feet. In Nahum, he is avengers of God's elect. In Habakkuk, he is God's ever evangelist crying out, revive thy works in the midst of the years. In Zephaniah, he is our Savior. In Haggai, he is the restorer of God's lost heritage. In Zechariah, he is the fountain opened up in the house of David for sin and uncleanliness. And in Malachi, he is the son of righteousness rising with healing in his wings. That's what was happening. And I'm telling you today that Jesus does the same thing. He reveals himself through his word. It's a gift, but we have to open it. And you're here this morning, maybe you're frustrated, maybe you got a hurting heart. Begin to open the scripture and let the Holy Spirit come alongside and illuminate and reveal to you just who Jesus is and how much hope we can have in him. Man, this is such good news. The journey with Jesus, I'm telling you, is such a joy because he comes for those of us who even maybe walked away and have our backs turned. He comes for those who maybe hearts right now are hurting. And also, number three, if you're taking notes, he comes for the blinded eyes. He comes for the blinded eyes. Oh, check this out. Verse 28. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going further. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over." So Jesus goes in to stay with them. Verse 30. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Verse 31. Then their eyes were open, and they recognized him. And he disappeared from their sight. Verse 32, they asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while we talked, while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and he has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way, on this journey, and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. So what was so important about Jesus breaking the bread that then their eyes were open, that then they recognized him, then they were able to see him clearly? Well, think about this. Think about what was hidden the whole time on the journey that was finally revealed. Think about this. Picture this. So Jesus, right, he takes the bread. And just as he has done probably countless times with his disciples, he took it and he blessed it and then he broke it. And then what does Scripture say he does with it? He says, and he gives it to them. See, what they would have seen in this moment were his scars. You see, scars tell a story, don't they? And these scars were telling an incredible story. You see, I even get this because in my life, I got a couple scars, and every single one of them carry with them an amazing story. Like, I have this scar right here on my elbow, and it's in the shape of teeth marks. See, I was playing basketball, and I went up to get a rebound, and my brother thought that he was going to get the same rebound, but that wasn't happening. And so his two front teeth got into my elbow and broke off up inside of there. Now, that's an awesome story to have over your little brother. I'm just telling you right now. Right here, I got this like 3-inch scar right here in my hairline. And it's from playing basketball again. As a matter of fact, I was here at church right up here in the upper parking lot. And we used to have this old Huffy backboard. Those of you that have been with us for a long time, you know what I'm talking about. Well, the rim wasn't attached to the pole, just to the fiberglass backboard. And I remember being a teenager and I went up and I dunked on this rim and I broke the rim off and the rim came down and cut me right here and I had to go get a tetanus shot and stitches. But I'm telling you right now, it was so worth it because of the story that I have. What other pastor do you know that's dunked a basketball and broke a backboard? Not very many, I can assure you that. But I have these amazing stories, right? And this story that Jesus had to tell because he was there with them, these scars told an amazing story, right? They were telling the disciples that what he said about himself was really true. That he was God and that he came born of a virgin, that he lived a completely obedient life to the Father, that he went to the cross to pay the sacrifice or to pay the price for sin because he loved us that much. He was placed in a grave, but 3 days later he got up, he's alive, and he lives, and we have the promise of everlasting life now knowing that. That's what these scars were telling them. That's why they couldn't contain themselves. It says they got up at once and immediately went back to Jerusalem. Well, it took them all day to get there, so guess what? They were walking at nighttime, but they didn't care. They had to tell somebody. You see, these scars told a story of Jesus' love for you. And that's why this journey with Jesus is so amazing and so good. I'm going to get the band to come back up and help me as I close. And I just want to talk just for a minute to those of you who maybe you've never started this journey with Jesus. Or maybe some of you started it a long time ago, or maybe as a kid, but for whatever reason, maybe you ventured away from the things of God. Maybe your journey has gotten too tough and you're just looking for something. Well, I'm telling you what you're looking for. You're looking for Jesus. And Jesus makes it so simple to start this journey. I want you to check out this verse. Romans chapter 3, verse 22 says this. I love this. Don't miss this. We are made right with God, meaning we start this journey. We start this journey in an incredible place. We are made right with God by placing our faith in Jesus Christ. Now, notice what it doesn't say. It doesn't say we're made right with God and start this journey by doing enough good things in our life. We don't start this journey. We're not made right with God by the bad things that we stop doing. It says we are made right with God by placing our faith. You see, it's not about behavior. It's about our belief in Jesus and what he's done on our behalf. It's that simple. That's the first step. You see, salvation isn't the finish line. It's the starting point of an incredible adventure lived with God. And I love what he goes on to say. And this is true for everyone who believes, no matter who we are. See, no matter who you are or what you've done, I'm telling you right now, Jesus came for you. Even though those times where you were walking away from him and you had your back turned toward him, he came for you. You have a hurting heart this morning, he came to reveal himself to you. Your eyes are shut up and you can't really see him. I'm telling you right now, he came to open your eyes, and the power of the Holy Spirit is in you. You just have to awaken to that reality. That the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in you. Can you open your eyes and see it? This is true for everyone who believes. And I'm telling you, Jesus did not come to just establish some religion. He came to start a relationship with you. You see, because religion is all just concerned about how well you perform, but Jesus is the one who performed for us on the cross and then when he got up out of the grave. You see, religion is all about what you can do, but in Christianity, in this relationship, it's all about what Jesus Christ has done. And that's why we celebrate. And you can begin this brand new journey today with Christ simply by placing your faith in him, simply by trusting, simply by believing. And I want to give you an opportunity to do that right now. So all across the room, just with heads bowed and eyes closed, we're going to pray. Father, I just pray right now that you just begin to do a miracle in this place. And we see miracle after miracle because of the perfect work of you. You know, the first thing that I want to pray for right now, I just know and understand that some of you, man, you are followers of Jesus. But you have loved ones that are not. And you hear this message today and you're like, man, I want to pray for them. Right now, if you're here and you say yes, there are people that I know and love, my family, my coworkers, close friends, whatever it is, and they don't know the freedom and grace that Jesus offers. And today, you want them to see Jesus. You want to pray for them. If that's you, would you just lift your hand up in this place? Man, we all know somebody. Father, today we pray for those who need your grace. Man, we would ask that you would do whatever it takes to bring them into a place of knowing and believing, that they would find true life in Jesus. Man, we thank you, God, that you'll hear our prayer and you'll do the miracle in their life. You know, just as we continue to pray, also there are many of you, you're here and you've been in church before. This isn't your first Easter. But for you, Jesus has just been in your head and you've been wrestling intellectually. He's never been in your heart. It's been more of a religious thing, not a relational thing. Well, guess what? If that's you today, you're going to let Jesus move from your head down to your heart. And I'm telling you, you'll never be the same again. Others of you, maybe you're not a church person. And right now, you can't even believe you're in church. You're like, man, well, hey, the roof hasn't fallen yet. It's almost done. I think I'm going to make it. But something is happening inside of you. You can feel it. You just feel this draw towards God. What is that? That is the loving kindness of God. That's his Holy Spirit doing what he does. God is reaching out to you right now in this moment, and he wants you to say yes to his love. There are those of you here, you're about ready to become a miracle right now. You're going to look back years from now on this day. Yeah, Easter 2017, man, I walked in one person and I walked out somebody completely different. Not a better version, but a brand new person, a new creation in Christ. The old is gone. Right now, some of you, man, you got the weight of weight of sin upon you. You feel guilt, you feel shame, but I'm telling you, when you confess your sin to God, He forgives you. He cleanses you of all unrighteousness. You become completely brand new, not because you're good, but because of the perfect work of Jesus. Right now, those of you that are in this room and say, yes, I need His grace. Yes, I need forgiveness. Today, by faith, I surrender my life to Him. If that's your prayer, and say, yes, I give my life to Him. Yes, that's my prayer. Would you just lift your hand up in this place right now? If that's your prayer, right there, yep. Up in the top, I see you. Anyone else? Just right now, wherever you're at, would you just pray this prayer? You don't have to pray it out loud, but just pray. It's pray, Heavenly Father, forgive me of all my sin. I give my life to You. Fill me with Your Spirit so I could follow You and serve You the rest of my life. My life is not my own. Today I give it to You. Thank You for new life. Now You have mine. And it's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.